Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome. My name is GamerLCD, and today we're going to be talking about the newly announced digital and collector's edition versions for The Elder Scrolls Online. These were recently announced this morning by ZeniMax on their various social media accounts. And so what I wanted to do is talk a little bit about them and go over them with you guys on this website. So first off, we have the digital standard edition, which is something that is, you know, of course, a digital copy of the game that you can just purchase or pre-order on their website. And, you know, it's some simple stuff here. You get to pre-order, you get 5 days early access. This is something that we see with a lot of new games, especially MMOs, where they allow you to play early if you pre-order their game, because they know there's a lot of people that aren't going to pre-order, and there's going to be a lot of people who wait until the last second to pick up the game. And, you know, those people who actually buy them in retail stores and stuff like that. So you get early access if you decide to pay now, give them your money now, and I don't know, maybe it'll be worth it, maybe it won't be. I guess it just depends on how excited you are for this game. Now, the second thing you get is that you get to play in any race in any alliance. So, as you guys know, there are 9 races and 3 alliances. So, basically, what this allows you to do is pick any of those races, and you can play any of those races in any alliance. So, normally, if you didn't have that perk, you would have to pick one of the three races in one of those 3 alliances. So, you have limited options. You can't play, you know, all 9 races in every single alliance. You're restricted to 1 alliance per 3 races. So if that made any sense to you guys, if not, let me know in the comment section below, and I'll be sure to answer that. Next thing you know, you get a little vanity pad that does nothing in the game, and you get a treasure map that, you know, shows you where to get, you know, various types of, you know, chests and loot and stuff like that. So obviously this isn't really a big deal. You know, this information is going to be online the first couple of weeks that the game is out anyway. So a bonus treasure map, you basically get to find extra stuff a little bit earlier than other people would be able to. So not really a big deal. So let's go ahead and move on to the Digital Imperial Edition. So this is why you basically get the same amount of stuff that the Digital Standard Edition gets, but there's one thing, and there's a couple of more things in here that is causing a little bit of controversy here. So let's go ahead and start with these extra vanity items here. So you get to play with an Imperial White Horse mount, and that gives you a little bit of increased mounting speed. Now obviously this wording is very, very vague, so you wouldn't be able to understand it. We really don't know what that's going to mean. Does it mean that my mount gets infinite amount of increased run speed? Does it mean that I only get 10% over the max, you know, that everyone else gets? Let's say the mounting speed in World of Warcraft is 280% for a flying mount. That's what it is. So would I get 290%? Would I get 300%? Who knows what the extra percentage is going to be. Now, of course, you get another vanity pet, the Murky Crab. Doesn't really do anything. Now, let's talk about the Rings of Mara here for a second. Why is this? This is one of those first controversies here. So, basically, if you pre-order the digital Imperial Edition, you get to play with your friend and gain bonus experience points. So once you complete the Ritual of Mara with your friend, which basically means that you link your accounts together, pretty much what that means, you get bonus experience until you hit max level with your friend. Now, obviously you don't have to play with him, but it is a really nice perk. Now why is it such a big deal? Well, it kind of takes away from that, you know, that giant rush to end game and see who can get to max level first. That comes with all brand new MMOs or a brand new expansion to an MMO like World of Warcraft. It takes that fun out of for those people that like to rush to get to the end game and, you know, like to claim that they were first to, you know, reach the max level and, you know, basically get to the end game first. So I know a lot of people aren't into that, but there are a lot of people that are, and it kind of ruins it for them, because if they didn't pre-order the digital, or, you know, the collector's edition, the Imperial edition, then they kind of left out of that race. And, you know, some people are really hardcore players or MMO players that don't really have the money to pre-order things right away, and so they have to wait till the last second to buy the game. So they're basically out of that race, even though they really enjoying that. And so the Rings of Mara really ruined that for them. And speaking as a 7-year World of Warcraft player, World of Warcraft has never ever done this. Sure, you get bind on account items that allow you to, you know, level up alts a little bit faster, but they've never allowed you to gain extra XP in a new expansion. You have to grind out just like everyone else. There's no way to earn bonus XP. There's no way to do any of that stuff. So for them to include a bonus experience, you know, item at the beginning of a brand new MMO, at the beginning of a brand new game, it kind of just ruins it for a lot of people who aren't able to pre-order. So the next thing that we want to discuss, and the final thing that comes with the collector's edition, or the Imperial Edition, because it is an Elder Scrolls game, is the fact that you are able to play as an Imperial. Now, playing as an Imperial allows you to play in any alliance, and you also gain unique bonuses and crafting styles, and you also get extra gear and other things that aren't listed here. So this is the main thing that's causing a lot of controversy in this collector's edition of the Elder Scrolls Online. Now, it is causing controversy because this is a $60 paid game, and it also has a $15 monthly subscription fee. So because I'm paying a subscription fee, and because this is not a free-to-play game, and because I'm paying a $60 to actually pick up this game, plus tax, of course, depending on where you live, I should be getting access to every single piece of content that is available in this game. Usually, this is how the free-to-play model works. So if they were taking the free-to-play model, then this wouldn't be a big problem to people, because free-to-play models allow you to pay for extra stuff. That's how they make money. You get to play the game for free, but if you want that, you'll have to pay some money. If you want to do this extra stuff over here, you have to pay some money. And since this isn't a free-to-play game, this is pissing a lot of people off because they're not getting access to all this content. When I pay a $60 game, when I pay for a $60 game, when I pay a monthly subscription fee on top of that $60 game, I should be getting access to all the content for me to experience and play with. If I'm missing out on content because I didn't spend 10 bucks over here, or if I didn't, you know, do this or do that, then I won't be able to have access to all that extra content. And so that's kind of pissing a lot of people off here. If they wanted to miss out on content, then they go play a free-to-play game. If they wanted to experience all the content that's available to them, then they would have, you know, not played the game. So take a regular Elder Scrolls game, for example, like Skyrim or Oblivion or Morrowind. When I bought the retail disc of that game, I had access to every single piece of content that was available on that game disc. Take Oblivion, for example. When I bought Oblivion, I had access to the arena. I didn't have to go pay 10 extra bucks to get access to the arena, you know, things like that. I didn't have to pay an extra $20 to go finish the main quest line, stuff like that. I didn't have to pre-order Oblivion to get access to, you know, whatever, that piece of legendary armor or whatever. And so that's what's kind of pissing a lot of people off. Personally, for me, like I've talked about this in other videos, is that I'm not really as interested in the Elder Scrolls as I used to be. They've just been going downhill. First, they added on the, you know, subscription fee. Then they talked about the, you know, I'm going to be missing out on content if I don't pre-order this or, you know, pick up that edition of the game and things like that. So ZeniMax and, you know, Bethesda are really going downhill with this game. And I want to see how long it lasts before they actually go to the free-to-play model, because they really wanted to this game from the beginning to be a premium service, which means that you pay money for this content, and we will give you a bunch of content in return. And I am paying, if I end up buying this game, then I'm going to be missing out on content, even though I already paid for the game, simply because I didn't, you know, pre-order, because I wasn't able to, you know, I didn't have the money to, or whatever, for whatever reason you couldn't do it. And so, you know, even if you don't want a digital copy of the game, you want a physical copy of the game, then you're also screwed. So there's a lot of problems with this. Personally, for me, I'm not as freaked out about it as most people are, simply because I don't think I'm going to be playing this game long term like some people have been planning to do since they first announced this game. But I want to know what you guys think about the digital and digital Imperial Standard Editions and the Imperial Editions of this game. Do these extra items that you're missing out on affect you because you are paying, you know, $75 for this game, $15 a month thereafter? How long do you plan on playing this game? Personally, for me, I'm planning to get this on the Xbox One or PlayStation 4, simply because I think it's going to be a better game played on a console rather than a PC with mouse and keyboard, simply because there's only, you know, 6 or 7 buttons that you really have to deal with, and all of that is, you know, Diablo 3 style. Diablo 3 worked really well on the consoles, and it only had very limited buttons that you had to work with. That's why it worked so well. And so I think that since the Elder Scrolls Online is similar to the way that our hotbar system works, I think it's going to work really, really well on consoles. So obviously you have the option of pre-ordering the PlayStation 4 or the Xbox One versions, so you guys can do that as well. There is still no official release date for the Xbox One and PlayStation 4 versions, except that it is coming in June, and the PC and Mac versions are coming in April. So There you guys have it. Those are the official collectors and digital standard editions of the Elder Scrolls Online. What do you guys think about the extra items that you get? Are you planning to pre-order? Are you still interested in this game? Let me know. I'm very interested. I want to hear people's thoughts and opinions about this game, because this game is causing a lot of controversy. It is a brand new experience to an Elder Scrolls game. So we'll have to see how it turns out. My name is GamerLCD, guys. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.